time for the last talk in this session before we can start the discussion. I'm happy to announce Anke Bramesfeld, who has just tested the quality of the American healthcare system, as you see. And she is a trained psychiatrist from nature and a professor in health services at the University of Hannover. And she has been involved in the development of clinical performance measures on the national level in an institute that was responsible for the mandatory quality management system, the AQUA Institute. You do know that in Germany we now have 279 indicators that are mandatory, but they are all guidelines based, and this was basically the work of the institute. And now she is sitting in Italy with the European Commission Breast Cancer Initiative, where a large scale program is set up to get quality assurance programs which raise all over Europe, and we are speaking about 37 countries, no, 36 after the Brexit. Thank you.
Oh, this is great. Oh, well, thanks for the nice introduction. Thank you for the invitation to this exciting conference. Before I start, I have a disclaimer, of course, no interest to declare, no conflict of interest to declare, but also, as Ina just said, I work for the AQUA Institute that used to be mandated to develop the mandatory quality assurance program for the German healthcare system, and I'm going to bring you tell you some examples on it. I will use it for examples. And at the moment, I'm working for the European Commission Initiative on Breast Cancer. We develop a voluntary quality assurance scheme for breast cancer services. Also, I will mention this. Well, I'm not, anything I'm saying is none of the opinions of the organizations I've been working for or I'm working currently for. So it's not the position of the European Commission. It's all my own experience. That's important to know. Just a few words where I'm coming from. The Joint Research Center of the European Commission, who does the European Commission's initiative against breast cancer, is the Joint Commission, the European Commission's in-house science center. So wherever there's a question that the European Commission feels has to be dealt with kind of independently, or is of a pan-European or pan-EU interest, they can give this research question to the Commission Center. Public health is only a very small part of it. It's located in different places in Europe. The biggest place is in northern Italy, that's where I'm based, in at the beautiful Lago Maggiore, actually. We're living at a place which other people go for vacation. So this is the agenda I'm going to get you through. First, I'm going to be talking a bit about what is quality assurance programs about. Then we develop person or patient-oriented quality assurance programs. I talk a bit about care pathways and quality potentials. And then I will give you some examples from developing quality assurance for schizophrenia, which we did in Germany. And of course, I draw conclusions. So what are quality assurance programs about? Like, bluntly speaking, or what they do, they assess the performance of different health services in a way that they can be compared as well longitudinally as between services. So that means they have a methodology that they apply to all those services, and this methodology for assessing the performance can be either quantitatively based, then by indicators, or it's a more qualitative methodology by audits or peer audits. Both is possible, both has got its plus and minuses, advantages and non-advantages. When working at AQUA, we invited other national quality assurance programs doing it mandatorily, and we asked them, what is the purpose of your program? And improving quality of performance is only one issue of quality assurance programs. Like, but improving quality of care is the one which is linked to guidelines. But the other purposes are providing data for health policy planning. It's providing patient choice, that's the idea, but publishing the results of performance of different health services, patients can make a choice and say, like, well, I want to have my hip replaced in this hospital because they have better outcomes or a higher number of patients treated, whatever, than in that hospital. It's about transparency, and it's about accountability to hold service providers accountable for the quality of care that they provide. Now, when we talk about quality of care, we have to be conscious about it, that it changes with the perspective that you're taking. Now, this is the famous public health triangle of health services, at least health, the triangle that you have in systems that are either health insurance-based or national health services. And whatever part, the service provider, patient, or cost carrier you're in, your perspective, what is quality of care, changes, meaning the point of reference where you kind of, your self-understanding of quality changes. Like for the cost carrier, quality means efficiency. So for how many money I'm spending as a cost carrier, how much health or outcome that is interesting for me as a cost carrier, and it's most times the healthy patient going back to work, do I get? The service provider has measures its quality according to guidelines, and they are process oriented, as you all know. As we doctors, we rally, especially in chronic disease, we rally to the outcome of what we do. So that's why we have to stick to processes. And the patient, system of reference for quality of care is the outcomes that matter to him. This is life quality, living independently. This is health, but this can be also being staying next to the family, or being able to eat again, whatever. Just don't confuse this. I was showing this to my students, this triangle. Don't confuse the positions, because like service providers, like, talking about guidelines, sometimes they also do recommend things related to efficiency, which is fine, but it's not actually the position of the physician, it's the position of the cost carrier. And the German Quality Assurance, Mandatory Quality Assurance Program, and also the ECIBC, the European Commission's Initiative Against Breast Cancer, both aim to try a patient or person-oriented perspective when talking about quality of care and when developing their quality assurance programs. So how do you do this, having developed a quality assurance program with wanting it to be patient-oriented? One way, you take some tools, and the tool I'm going to be introducing now to use the tool of having a care pathway and using quality potentials. That means before you start developing the program, you try to draw a flowchart how the way the patient takes through the system when becoming sick. And there are certain points where decisions are made for this is the care pathway for severe mental illness. So the patient with a disease comes in from there, and then there is a hazard, and the patient deteriorates maybe a lot or not. Depends, either has to go lower to hospital care or stays in outpatient care. And in this care pathway, you can identify specific points, specific moments where the performance of the service providers does change the quality of care from the perspective of the patient, from the outcome. The outcome in a patient-related outcome in severe mental illness is living independent, for example. Living independent. So based on health service research available, based on also expert interviews, you identify these points of where the performance matters for the quality. This is the quality potentials. And you can have very specific quality potentials. For example, you have up there, right before the outpatient care, you have the quality potential for coordination.
coordinated approach, but you have also like quality potentials for additional therapies, for psychotherapy, for pharmacotherapy, etc. And there are also cross-cutting quality potentials such as psychoeducation, such as self-help, such as restraint, coercive treatment, such as continuity or family involvement. And you want to make sure once you progress, you have these quality potentials kind of in mind, and check what you develop for the quality assurance program according to your quality potentials. Next thing you do, or we do, they did in Germany, the Aqua Institute did, and now we're doing it with the European Commission, is we develop requirements or indicators depending on which system you're talking to, whether they are called. So that means you first of all look for indicators and requirements out there in the literature, in indicator databases, and of course in current guidelines. Yes, the link to the guidelines. And you collect them all. And then you have an expert panel which you propose this this pool to. And this expert panel, of course, includes patients. Well, the schizophrenia is also included families as a it's basic in mental health care that you include both patient representative as family representatives. And you check in this pool whether some requirements miss. Maybe the, you know, you didn't find in the literature and current guidance some requirements, but would you think they're important? So this is also talked with the expert panel. And if you have quality potentials not being addressed by existing indicators, you create new ones. All these indicators go now through a whole process. Those that are meeting the predefined inclusion criteria are out, and the others go through a panel process, a Delphi-like process, where you first evaluate these indicators for understandability and relevance. And relevance means, well, they're based, you consider their evidence base. But you also consider whether these indicators are able to distinguish between good performance and bad performance. You also consider whether these indicators are actionable. Can the service provider, in fact, do something about these indicators? Or it's something, you know, he doesn't have a handle. For example, patients sent against their will to hospital. This is done by mainly their lawyers and by the outside. Well, it's by lawyers and a specific part of the public health system. So the hospital actually has no hand on it. They get sent the patient there to deal with them. So this wouldn't be a good indicator for that is actionable. And of course, you look at whether your indicators have perverse incentives. Because you can also induce, well, indicators are meant to induce a specific performance. Just make sure you're not over-inducing something. All the indicators that made it through the first round about understandable and relevance are then done in the second round, where they are evaluated for being technically feasible. That means, can they be, in fact, be assessed, these indicators? Is data available? Or is it possible that the service provider assesses additional data? Maybe there's some additional data. Is it possible because, I mean, they're packed with administrative documentation? Is this so important that additional documentation can be asked for this? The rest of those, in the end, after this panel process, you have a set of indicators. They are then made available to a public consultation. With the German system was about a consultation, a public consultation with the stakeholders. The European Commission's initiative against breast cancer will make the indicators available to the countries and will ask, well, can you technically assess these indicators within your health system? And it's, then after that, indicators will be adjusted, etc. And then they will, of course, be pilot tested before rolled out. So how do we do? About the indicators that we chose by the system, I want to give you some examples from the German experience with developing indicators for schizophrenia. What is important once you start developing indicators, especially for the point of feasibility, that you know about the preconditions, what methods are available to you.
So first of all, you have to know that it was mandated by the Federal German Committee. This is this body in Germany that does tell the health insurance and the health system as such what to provide. It's not the health ministry in Germany, it's this committee. Never mind. They mandated it. They're responsible. Okay, yes. So they're one of these indicators. The preconditions were that this quality assurance program is mandatory. That means it will concern all about 500 psychiatric hospitals in the country and all about 2,000 outpatient centers or outpatient offices, as most of the outpatient care in Germany is provided by office-based physicians or psychiatrists. This program only books indicators that don't have audits implemented. And the data sources for these indicators available were health insurance claims data, which provide information about diagnosis, days of admission, outpatient, and for outpatient, you can have diagnosis, physician seen, the date when the physician was seen, medication prescribed, things like that. You can have extra documentation, but only in hospital care, not in outpatient care. And their patient survey is not available. It's not implemented yet. There was, however, a guideline available, the S3 guideline, schizophrenia, a bit outdated, but the best as we can get. It's been updated since years. This is working on it for years. So, taking from this guideline, the first recommendation, a strong recommendation, a type grade A recommendation on pharmacotherapy. So the guideline says the treatment of acute schizophrenic episodes, antipsychotics should be the treatment of first choice. I kicked something down here. And I know what I did. She kicked something down there. Okay, I can tell you a story. I just go on while we fix this. guidance is acute episode, antipsychotic first, the first choice. And it's a strong recommendation. Well, the first question is this a fault of attention? Well, no, it's not a fault of attention because this is the basic, everybody knows it, everybody does it. So none of the experts, none of the health services studies we looked at, nobody ever said this is the problem that antipsychotics are not given. Second, is it a patient preference? Well, I can't tell you that always. And it's quite difficult to get patients who do not want to have antipsychotics as a first-line treatment. If they're not threatening themselves extremely, you can't give it to them. And third, there are some about perverse incentives. There are some avant-garde treatment approaches where they try to help patients with an acute episode, not giving them antipsychotics, but they give them a lot of time, a lot of care, a lot of quiet things. And it works for some patients, it works in some places. The places have to know how to do it. So this one speaks against having this as an indicator. It's not a quality potential. Oh, and there is no routine data available for it. You would have to ask the hospital to do additional documentation on this. So this all speaks against it having it as an indicator. And we didn't do an indicator, although it's great. A recommendation, but we consider it being not a relevant indicator. Second example, it's polypharmacology in outpatient care. So the guideline says, in principle, antipsychotics should not be combined. So you should not give more than one antipsychotic because it only adds side effects, it doesn't reduce much about effects. There are some
you know, some situations where you will although you want to give two antipsychotics, most times it's a long, anyway, there's some, you know, but there may arise a occasion where you may give two antipsychotics. Well, is this a quality potential? Well, yes, it is. As data says that 70% of all patients in outpatient care get more than one antipsychotic for a longer time, and many of them even get three antipsychotics. So this is a clear quality potential. And patient preferences, we don't know this issue, but we can imagine they are also not up to so many medication. So we build an indicator on it also. In addition, our data on pharmaceuticals is available in the healthcare claims data for all patient care also. And the indicator was that it measures antipsychotic combination therapy, that's what it calls, and it counts all patients that receive more than three different antipsychotics for more than two quarters of a year. Well, two quarters is, you know, this is the set when you get the data, so you only get the quarters. That's how it is. But also, we didn't take two because this would be a too big gray area. So the indicator is very pragmatic and goes to the extreme. We only measure those who get three antipsychotics for a too long time. Because these are the real, this is for sure not a good treatment. Or with two, you know, you may be overlapping by changing the medication, whatever. You want to have a clear message from the indicator. You only get it if you take it to the extreme. Third indicators was a coercive treatment. Well, the guideline doesn't say much about it. They did a little recommendation on it. It says that methotrexate is restrained or seclusion should only be used in exceptional emergency, are to be documented and explained to the patient. And I think this should be basic. Well, this is a quality potential because if there's one thing that patients are very much concerned about, is that they may be coerced or they may be going to restraint in hospital once they are in an acute episode. And it's a patient priority not to be exposed to this situation. On the other hand, of course, it's also treatment of patient of security. And believe it or not, there's no transparency about restraint being used. Hospitals document it. It needs to be documented, but it's not reported neither on the on a local basis nor on a on a national basis. So, like, we don't know how much restraint is used in one hospital or the other one, not for public data. And the panel built three indicators on it. First is the number of patients exposed to restraint seclusion, because you want to have it used as few patients as possible. The second is the total time that the patients are exposed to restraint or seclusion, because you want them to be exposed to this treatment as short as possible. And the third one, the number of patients receiving one-to-one care during restraint or seclusion, because you want to have a nurse sitting next to them all the time they are secluded or all the time they are restrained to see that they can help them and not leave them alone. So the third indicator was coming in as an indicator proposed by the group. There are no studies on it, but it's good practice. It's something also recommended by the patient, but also was recommended by some of the physicians actually doing it in their hospitals there. So this is an example where you don't have a strong recommendation, but you get indicators which are really vital, very, you know, putting it, looking at a point which is really relevant for patients and for their priorities. So what is the problem? Why couldn't we kind of translate, you know, why didn't it like one-to-one translate the guideline to the quality assurance indicators? Well, the problem is that quality assurance and guidelines take different perspectives, have a different understanding of what is quality of care. The guideline is the service provider's point of view, and the quality assurance program aims at having a patient-oriented view. Also, guidelines do not cover all processes that are relevant from a patient perspective. And I think even if you do the best guideline in the world, there will be always something you're going to be missing.
guidelines stick to the strength of evidence, but not to the strength of relevance from a patient's perspective. But a quality assurance program should take into account the strength of relevance from a patient's perspective. And the guidelines do not have the concept of quality potential as much as I know, but you may know better. Well, the European Commission's initiative against breast cancer now aims to cross the gap between guidelines taking the physician's view and quality assurance schemes and having them all both patient-oriented. They do this by, first of all, using this methodology with panels and panels of course patients, their patients who is involved in all processes, and they produce their own guideline, the European breast guidelines for screening and diagnosis, and they are supposed to be patient-oriented as well, so they have patient-oriented guidelines. So I come to the end and I conclude. The message I want to say to tell you is like conscious on your perspective that you take for quality of care. And for patient person-oriented quality assurance, it's recommended to orient about ethical care pathway of patients and think about quality potentials. Of course, patients and persons should be included in all processes. Guidelines need to be respected as they are the source of evidence, but they're not the only source of reference for quality assurance. The question is, if guidelines would be more patient-oriented or increasingly more patient-person-oriented, will the recommendations be better or more be translated to performance measurement? That's about to be seen. Thank you for your attention.